So, that's me, and I want to talk a bit about extension to core. So how do you find the stuff in core code that is in your extension and the extension API? And Olivier just said, have you seen this horrible API or LibreOffice.org thing? Actually, I think it's not too bad, but I agree that up to now, finding something there, once you're there, it's okay, but finding something is the hard part. So, well, actually, that is true up until last weekend, essentially, at least if you're running master of LibreOffice, so I'll get into that. So, first I have to say I have no idea what I'm doing when I'm talking about UNO and all that stuff. There are others who are much better informed about the details, but let me just give you a quick run through the concepts so that we know what we're talking about. So interfaces, services, and implementations, and I use some lame comparisons to introduce them. Interfaces are what you can do when you have some UNO thing. They're usually named Comsan star something and have a name that starts with X, and then there's a description of what kind of things you can do with them. Services provide a set of interfaces, so they are essentially a collection of stuff you can do with something, and they usually start with Comsan star and have not an X at the beginning. And then you have implementations. They are what actually implements a service. One concrete example, and they are usually named whatever. So if you look at them, they have a bazillion different ways to be named, which is kind of unfortunate. But they are the actual stuff that is in LibreOffice and that does something. So just to make that a bit more visible, I came up with some weird examples, which are not, of course, real life use in LibreOffice, but interfaces are stuff like, okay, I have a cargo storage, I can put something in, I can take something out, and it has capacity or something. And I have a transport, something that goes somewhere that I can start traveling and stuff like that. And I can combine those to a lorry service where I can put stuff in and get it somewhere, but it's still abstract, it's still some lorry, it's not one concrete lorry. And the implementation then is one specific lorry, one very individual one, with its own decorations and bugs. So this is to get you the idea of what is an implementation, what is a service, and what's an interface. So what can we do with UNO runtime reflection? So when you have some UNO thing, to actually find out what kind of UNO thing you have there. And the first thing is X interface, which is essentially everything in UNO has an X interface. So it says base interface of all UNO interfaces. And the only thing you can do there essentially is ask if it can implement some other interface. Because in itself, it's not of much use by itself. The second thing that can help us there is the X type provider, and there we can actually get a sequence of types, so we can get an information of which interfaces are implemented by this specific thing that I have at hand. So with this I can find out if it's, for example, if it's an X transport or if it's an X cargo storage or whatever. So with that I can find out what I can actually do with it. And then there's X service info, and there I can ask actually which services are supported. So either ask support service, or I can get the list of all the services that are supported by this thing. This is already pretty abstract and stacking stuff on concepts on top of concepts. When you're there like coding your little basic or Python script, I assume it's you don't want to go all these steps. So this is why I introduced the CompSun-Star script service documenter single. It sounds even more complex, but this is something you can start once in your basic IDE. And then you have show service docs, and whatever you have as a new thing in, for example, basic, you can just throw in there, and it opens all the documents for this thing, which are on api.libreoffice.org. So the hard problem that Olivier described, you go on this web page and you can't find anything, is at least it's a lot easier to just take, I have this thing and I want to have documentation about what I have here. And if you are in this developing your basic script, you can use that. And you can, of course, if you're like doing that in, even if you're developing stuff in C++, you can use the basic IDE to just walk to the thing that interests you and find out what it actually is. You can also, so the first thing shows the services, and the second thing shows the interfaces. The interfaces are actually a lot more. If you do that for the classic writer document, so this component, if in basic, if you have a writer document open, the first one will open something like 10 services, which is okay-ish, and this one will open more than 40 tabs in your browser. So yeah, but you get all the documentation for this stuff to work. So what you can, what do you have to do, for example, in basic to get to this? Well, you have to get the service documenter, and then you have to, then you can use it to show whatever this component or whatever new object you have actually does. In the middle, I just added the old stuff that was there before, and in case you didn't know it, which just pops up. A message box with the methods and properties and interfaces, but you can't click on them, you can't, they are not linked and there's no further help in those. And I wonder if I actually should make this first line superficial by making it a global thing like Star Desktop that is always there in basic. So you would never need to write the first line and you would only use the last one and just say, okay, I know what this is that I have here. So this is the stuff using the UNO API from the outside, not looking into core. But actually, I want you to look into core, because if you have a bug that you find in UNO interface, it's much better for the LibreOffice project if you're not only able to say, it's broken, but also find the way how to, where the code is and fixing it, or even either look at it and see if there's further things you can do. So the other interesting thing is find out the actual implementation that does the stuff that you're working with in the core. And well, the old way to do that, for example, is you ask your object get implementation name, then you get an implementation name, and then you enter this string into openwork.libreoffice.org. The problem with that is you get like a bazillion hits from test code and everything, which is instantiating this specific service. So it works, but it's not really that that nice to use. The second thing I did was, well, the first thing I did was just finding there these component files in the LibreOffice source tree, and you can find them, and from that you can see where something is implemented, or at least you can guess it if you have some experience. And the best solution probably is write a Clang plugin, and whenever you compile LibreOffice, and whenever LibreOffice is told to compile the get implementation name thing, you know, okay, this is some unified thing, and then you find out, you look what this method actually returns, and you have the mapping from the C++ class to the implementation name. The ad hoc version with the component files was some it's pretty hackish, but it works to get you the rough idea where code this is. And you can take it from there. But of course, the better solution is really to do it with a Clang plugin. I haven't finished that yet. Stefan Bergmann did write a prototype of that. And because I had a different Clang version and stuff, it didn't work out on my machine yet. But I will finish this work to get this complete auto-generated mapping between the C++ implementation and the implementation name. And with that, when you have that, I would generate a redirect page to docs.libreoffice.org, which is actually documenting the core LibreOffice classes. And by now you can, it's just an example, if you tell it that you want to have this is my personal upload location, if you go there and tell it this is the base URL, you can actually use it for one class, which is the text document thing, and you will get the documentation on docs.libreoffice.org for the SWX text document. So the plan, of course, is to have this all generated for all classes, for all unit implementations, and have that automatically generated for each version, so that you can essentially do this, show core docs for whatever unit interface you have, and then really get to the C++ code documentation. I think that's not done yet, but I plan to do that maybe in the next week. And we can, of course, do other nifty stuff on top of that, like linking to GitHub or OpenGrok with, once we have the C++ class name, and with that make it easier for someone who's looking from the outside with a Nuno object to actually find where's the C++ code for that. Okay, so that's the talk, and I can demo that on, I hope I can demo that on this machine. The only thing I noticed which doesn't work, at least on, or that works different on this machine, just to demo this. I open a writer document. So this is the stuff, and if I run it, I first get what this the old debug functions where I can see what services, properties, and interfaces it has, and then it opened the documentation for this on the other screen. So, I can pull that over, but you have the expected document reference there. And it also works for the core object, but only for this one class where I did the, I created the HTML directly manually. So that's work to do. Questions? Yes?
Is it possible to just get the C++ class name? So if you are not interested in all these nice open something in my browser or whatnot, I have my, in case I have the source code indexed locally already, then just having the class name?
It's a bit tricky because what I wanted, well, the plan currently is to create the mapping from the implementation name to the C++ class name and put these in these redirect files on the web page. Otherwise, you would have to put the whole list and ship them with LibreOffice. I don't want to do that, to always and then update in LibreOffice the reflection list which maps the C++ implementation name to the C++ name to the human implementation name.
In some cases, we already have this, the C++ class name is the same as the implementation name.
Yeah.
And I wonder if it would be a good idea to form the, this would be consistent everywhere, and then you can just query for the implementation.
That would be another idea. I thought about, well, we should just always use the...
It's something that possibly could be enforced by some compiler plugin. I just don't know
if it would cause
some pain for...
It would... I assume it would cause huge pain for both the extension developers, because they... if you just take a random implementation name and put it into Google and you see people using these implementation names. So whatever that did will break.
Even if it's not published, people already depend on that.
Yeah, okay. And that's the first thing. And the other thing, of course, all the tests, at least the, I mean, it would be an excuse to kill off the Java UNO API tests, because they, otherwise you would have to adjust all of them. That would be, I don't think anyone would volunteer to do that.
There's also these special cases where there's multiple implementations of a single marker kind of service, and then you traditionally always go via the implementation names to discriminate among these implementations. So there's precedent galore of using these implementations.
Okay.
But I agree. This if you look at this and you have this client plugin telling you all the implementation names that are used, I have the list now. And you look at it, and it's completely inconsistent in a bazillion different ways. What kind of strings are used there? Sometimes it's the C++ name. Sometimes it's comsunstar something. Sometimes it's comsunstar comp. Something. So it's what one could at least do is have a base class or this service packet thing that we are using, create a default from now on, and then we might at least kill off the old stuff which is not dependent upon manually, maybe with an easy hack. But we have to see if there might be some that are causing regressions that we then still have to be inconsistent. So, other questions? Olivier, does this help at least a bit in finding the documentation? Or?
Yeah, I hope so, because you know, this is a. The API is very powerful, but for the average user that is used to call VBA statements, you know, it's amazingly complex.
Yeah, I agree. Okay, if there are no other questions, thank you.